for little bit more physics or you know fundamentals. Internal flow lends itself to lot of discussion actually. It's very, very conceptually, what you say, stimulating. I think that is the right word, because you think we think we have understood many things, but we have not understood honestly. So today I understood many things when he taught external flow. So same thing, internal flow, unfortunately, again as it is taught in the undergraduate curriculum, is just correlations, okay, unfortunately. And that is in fact how far away from reality that you are, that is what we are doing. Internal flow can be taught very beautifully when you again couple fluid mechanics with the heat transfer. Now as I said, you cannot separate, they are like the two wheels of the train, you have to have them together. So always, always, always I have to keep that in mind. So just whatever, if I have a doubt, fluid mechanics will tell me, oh this is the reason for it, I can explain many things because of that. Anyway, so internal flow refers to any flow through a confined environment, confined geometry, circular pipe, rectangular pipe, triangular, any such geometry. And so all of us are familiar with this concept of average or mean velocity. So when we give problems or when we have seen textbook problems, oil flows through a pipe with an average with a velocity of 2 meters per second, it is essentially the average velocity which is given to us. Everybody knows that there is a velocity profile, there is a distribution associated with respect to r. We don't worry about center line velocity or velocity at r/2 or anything, we just give the average velocity, okay. So this slide essentially tells you how to calculate the average velocity. This average velocity has no physical meaning except that, as he has rightly said, it is our engineering approximation. But it is not an approximation, it is just a number which is obtained very nicely by one fundamental equation, which is conservation of mass. So I am equating the mass flow rate calculated by means of this average velocity to the actual mass flow rate which I will get by using the velocity profile. So rho cross sectional area times Vm, which is the average velocity. Books will call it u bar, v bar, um, vm, whatever it is, it is just the mean or average velocity. That is equal to rho v dA. This v is the local velocity. So conventionally we are used to doing this to help students understand. I will also do that. We take a circular pipe and we say for a fluid element elemental ring of radius at radius r and thickness dr, the area of this ring is nothing but dAc is equal to 2 pi r dr, and velocity at that for that ring is r, x. Question, okay. So I will say dm dot is essentially rho dAc times v of rx, correct. M dot is rho av. So I am writing the mass flow rate through the differential element, and when I integrate this over the entire cross sectional area, it will give me the mass flow rate through the cross section of the pipe. That I am setting equal to rho v r comma x 2 pi r dr equal to some average, mean, pseudo, whatever you want to call, some value times rho times cross sectional area of the pipe is given by pi r squared, okay. And when I do the maths, I will get v mean is nothing but 2 by r squared integral 0 to r v of r comma x r dr, okay. So this is all given there, and so this is essentially the average velocity. So if I know the velocity distribution, then I can calculate, compute, evaluate the mean or average velocity, which is what is given to an engineer. Okay, I need a velocity of this. Our Reynolds number is based on this average velocity. Okay, so though there is a velocity distribution, we don't care about it. We do care about it, but for calculating Reynolds number, etc., we use this average value. Okay, and the profiles are rightly drawn here. The idealized profile is shown like this. Is this correct physically? It is not correct, right? Because it violates no slip condition. So, this is an idealized profile, this is the actual velocity profile, and when students draw it also, if we say these are some common mistakes they make, they will draw the vertical line somewhere here to show. It cannot be, logically it has to be much smaller than the value of Vmax. Common mistakes which students make. So, I think that concept of mass balance, if it is ingrained, such mistakes will not happen. Okay. Now, if there is a mean or average velocity, then there should be a mean or average temperature. Okay. So, temperature profile, yesterday when we did boundary layer, we told about the temperature distribution. We said if surface temperature is greater than the fluid temperature, let us just revisit this. For internal flow, I will have this is x is equal to 0. And this is the center line of the pipe, r equal to 0, r equal to r, y coordinate is measured from the wall of the pipe, r is measured from the center line upward, fluid is coming in with a velocity u infinite, u mean, and T infinity is the free stream temperature. Okay. So, we all know hydrodynamic boundary layer. Let me just draw it for the sake of completeness. If a student has successfully completed fluid mechanics, he should be able to draw this for us, right? What do we segregate the pipe into now? This is the hydrodynamic boundary layer, okay, delta of x. This region, which is inside the boundary layer, is where you have viscous effects. This part, which is outside, is the inviscid core. This inviscid core progressively decreases because you have to think in three dimensions. The boundary layer develops all around the circumference, and ultimately at some location it will merge completely, and this we will call as the hydrodynamic entrance length or entry length. All of us are familiar with this. If I have to draw the velocity profile at any of this location, it will be something like this, and then a straight line in the inviscid core. Why is it a straight line in the inviscid core? Will it be the same as the free stream velocity? It will be greater. Why will it be greater? Mass balance. So, if the velocity initially or inlet velocity, I will just draw it here for want of space, is this average velocity Vm shown by a line of length so much. This mass flow rate is rho times cross sectional area of the pipe times Vm. That has to be balanced by this whole area, because in the boundary layer the velocity distribution is such that the velocity is smaller than Vm. This magnitude of the velocity in the inviscid core has to be larger than the velocity of Vm. It is like a cone which is extruded. Okay. How many of you are with me on this concept? Velocity at Maluswami, velocity in the inviscid core will be larger than the average or mean velocity. Nitin, clear? Everybody, Because see, these are things which a student always has a doubt, why, and books will not explain, because it is obvious for textbooks to explain these things. Okay, when once I come to a region which is beyond the hydrodynamic entry region, what do we call this flow in this part? Fully developed. Everybody familiar with this term, fully developed flow? What do we mean by fully developed flow? We answered this question yesterday also. Fully developed flow, hydrodynamically fully developed. Fixed. So, if I take the velocity distribution here, I am drawing a profile. The V max here, will it be smaller than V m or larger than V m? Again, larger than V m, for the same reason, because in these portions the mass flow rate velocity is smaller than V m. This is my pseudo V m. Okay. This velocity distribution, whatever I have drawn, paraboloid, three dimensional parabola or figure obtained by rotation of this parabola, it is called as a paraboloid. This paraboloid will have the same form at any x location downstream, downstream of the portion where the boundary layers have met. That means, in the hydrodynamic entry region, all this activity will happen. Beyond that, if I take a velocity profile at x1 and I measure the velocity profile at some other downstream location, it should come out to be identical. If not, then the flow has not yet developed fully. Okay. So, this is fully developed flow. Okay. So, I think this is also there here. There is nothing which will not be there in the set of slides. The slides are so complete, thanks to him. So, velocity boundary layer, velocity profile. This is the inviscid core. The inviscid core region shrinks, and this is the hydrodynamically fully developed velocity distribution. And we have to write this d by dx of v is equal to 0. That means, there is no change in the velocity profile downstream from this location. Okay. Such a region we will call as a hydrodynamically fully developed region. Okay. Now, let us come to temperature. Life becomes a little difficult as we saw yesterday. We had already in fluid mechanics, we had two velocities, local velocity u and u infinity in case of external flow. Now, when I did internal flow, I have a local velocity and a mean velocity. Temperature, external flow, I had T surface, T infinity, T local. Okay. Here, in internal flow, I have, if I have a heated pipe, I will have a surface temperature T s. The fluid will come in with some initial inlet temperature, which is T infinity. After that, the T infinity has no value. Okay. So, then there is a local temperature, and then one very important, very useful measured temperature, which we call as mixing cup temperature. Okay. So, we say water coming out at 80 degrees centigrade. This 80 degrees centigrade is essentially, if you take water flowing from that heater or geyser or whatever, take it in a cup, stir it well, put in a thermometer, it will show 80 degrees centigrade. That is what it means. It is called as a mixing cup temperature. It is not a magic word. It is just saying that it is a well mixed, homogenized mixture, where all the temperature variations across the radius is nullified, or it is the energy thermodynamic equilibrium. Okay, that is what it means. So, this mixing cup temperature is playing the same role as your average or mean velocity. So, this temperature is what we use in most engineering applications. We say that hot oil at 100 degrees centigrade is used to heat cold water heat exchanger, classic problems which are there. What is 100 degree centigrade? When it is flowing through the pipe, we know that the temperature is going to change along the radius, but this 100 degree centigrade refers to the mean temperature. Properties are evaluated at this temperature, calculations are done based on this temperature, MCP delta T, temperature at inlet, at outlet, we take only the average values. What is this average or mixing cup value? That we will see here, and I will draw the diagram again, but it is drawn here very nicely. This is the temperature profile for a case where TS, surface temperature, is greater than the fluid temperature. That means heat is coming from the wall into the fluid, fluid is getting heated. This profile, it is very hard for me to get temperature at every location. So, I will change this temperature to this dashed line, which we will call as Tm. Some constraint has to be there, otherwise if there is no constraint, then there is no fun in life. So, we say just as mass flow rate was conserved, your energy content has to be equated. So, all I am doing is energy of that fluid element. Okay. So, this profile fluid will have a different energy in this region as opposed to this region, because its temperature is different. So, I am integrating the mass flow rate for every elemental ring, mass flow rate times Cp times the temperature at that element, m dot Cp times the local temperature, that is the energy content of that fluid element ring. Not clear? Anybody who is not clear in this, please.
I imagine always, he used very right word, ring. So, you imagine so many stream tubes, you know, each one is coming, each stream tube is coming with a definite temperature. So, if I average the energy of each stream tube and imagine a temperature, that is going to be the bulk fluid temperature or the mixing cup temperature. Mixing cup temperature is so said because, as he said, that is how we measure also mixing cup temperature. We put it in a cup and we mix it. Then only I will get the mixing cup temperature. So, I imagine always stream tubes, different stream tubes, each one carrying different energies. If I equate these energies and imagine a temperature, that temperature is my mixing cup temperature.
Right. Enthalpy essentially. Cpt is enthalpy. Okay. I think for benefit of those whom it is not very clear, I have tried to draw it. See, this is the cross section of the pipe. Okay. All of us appreciate that there is a velocity profile. Okay. So, this I have taken a fluid element ring at radius r and thickness dr. So, imagine it is like an extrusion, just the ring which is coming out. Okay. Madam. So, it is like a pipe of a certain thickness which is being extruded. The fluid element is of that thickness and it is coming out. That fluid element will have a velocity which is given by the local velocity associated with that position, u of r comma x. Similarly, it will have a temperature associated by virtue of a temperature profile. Its temperature will not be Ts, it will not be this temperature, it will be some local temperature given by the magnitude of this length. Okay. So, now what I am saying is energy content for that fluid element dE is nothing but dE dot, because it is flowing, it will be mass flow rate of the fluid through that element times Cp times T of r comma x. Mass flow rate of the fluid times the enthalpy associated with that fluid elemental ring. Enthalpy I am writing in terms of Cp times T for an incompressible fluid. T essentially why? Because we are interested in the temperature distribution. We are not concerned with enthalpy distribution, we are concerned with temperature distribution. So, this is T comma Rx. This m dot, as we did in velocity, it is going to be rho u of r comma x, that is where I am marrying fluid mechanics with heat transfer. So, this is the bride, this is the groom, okay. You cannot separate, okay. U of r comma x times dAc, this is the mass flow rate, this multiplied by Cp multiplied by T of r comma x. This is the infinitesimal control volume energy, flow of energy. This ring extends from r is equal to 0 to r is equal to capital R. So, the total energy is obtained by integration. This is over the entire cross sectional area. AC will be written as 2 pi r dr, and the integral will go from 0 to capital R. Energy conservation tells me whatever energy I do by this method integral should be the same as energy content if I took that entire fluid into a cup, put in a temperature, I mean mixed it and put in a thermometer, I will get a temperature which we call as the average or mean or mixing cup temperature. So, I will say this is also equal to m dot Cp times T mean or T mixing cup. And this m dot now again is not based on local values, this will be our rho A, which is pi r square, and V mean or um, sorry, I have written um, the nomenclature is Vm, it means the average velocity. Mass flow rate evaluated using the average velocity times Cp times the so called mixing cup temperature whose magnitude I have to find out. Okay. So, if I do the maths, I will just get a very simple dirty looking integral equation, which will be nothing but T mean is equal to 1 over rho pi r square Cp. Okay. Times um, correct. Anything I miss out, please point out. Integral 0 to r, let us be slow here, times rho times 2 pi r times Cp times u of r comma x times T of r comma x times dr. Every term is included, incompressible, rho is cancelling off, pi, pi cancels off, Cp, Cp cancels off. So, I am left with 2 over r squared um or Vm, I am sorry, I am sticking with um, integral 0 to r u of r comma x T of r comma x r dr. This is your mean mixing cup average temperature. Let us just go back and write our average or mean velocity, and average or mean velocity was a very very nice and simple equation, which was 2 by r square integral 0 to r u of r comma x r dr. Look at these two equations. Has not life become very complicated suddenly? Product of two distributions, both of which are functions of r comma x, that has to be integrated with respect to r. Mathematically, yes, you can do it, but conceptually, because of the flow of the fluid and the fact that it has a different velocity at every location, temperature also is changing at every location. Okay. And this mixing cup temperature or average temperature is what is specified in our problems most of the time. Okay. And we have to appreciate that this mixing cup of average temperature is something which is given for convenience, but despite it being something something which is generated for convenience, it is so useful that it has become indispensable. Okay. So, cutting all this, we go back to the slides. I have used um, it's vm here, it's the same thing. So this is the expression. You don't have to ask the student to memorize this. Okay, this comes from fundamental. I don't remember this. I'm sure he also doesn't remember this. But given a velocity and temperature profile, student should be able to get an expression for the average or mean temperature. We will do it when we do the derivation for Nusselt number for constant wall heat flux case. Okay. Any questions on this average temperature? Deliberately we have gone slow, but if it is clear, I think life becomes a lot easier. It is not just to get a set of fluid properties. I will explain that in a minute. When I evaluate heat transfer coefficient H, okay, we are going little 5-6 slides more there or faster than what we are. How is Q? What is Q double prime? Q is equal to H times Q is equal. I will write down for you. Why ask? Why speak in air? Q is equal to Q double prime is equal to H times. Please tell me, help me. Ts minus T infinity. Okay. Okay. External flow. I will accept this equation because there is only one T infinity. Okay. Internal flow. Where is this T infinity for you? T infinity is gone. Once the fluid has come inside this confined environment, which is at either uniform surface temperature or uniform wall heat flux, there is no concept of T infinity anymore. T infinity is history. So what do we deal with? We have to, it plays the similar role of Tm, but very, very important, Tm is not a constant. Why? Because if I take this pipe, I will just go to two slides later, it is drawn. If I take the profile at, we will explain all this little later. I am just showing a temperature profile where the fluid is hotter than the wall and heat is going to go out. A temperature distribution here versus another temperature distribution here will not be the same, because heat is being lost by the fluid to the ambient, because there is heat transfer. Because the Q is a finite number, this, if I keep Ts fixed, Tm will have to change. This profile will become a little bulged inwards, it will come inwards. Okay. Unlike T infinity, which was a constant all through the flow, I did not bother. You know, air flows over a plate at a velocity of 30 meter per second and T infinity of 25 degree centigrade. 25 remained 25, we did not change it. Here at every location my Tm is going to change, and that produces an additional complexity because I have to track the variation of Tm at every point. So my heat transfer coefficient definition therefore would be Q double prime is equal to H is equal to Q double prime divided by T surface minus Tm. Am I clear?
Local value.
Local value. Okay. If Q double prime is fixed, this is constant, these two are changing. If this is fixed and these two are changing, whatever it is, H is going to be a local quantity. If neither of these are fixed, life becomes even more difficult. Okay. Is everybody with me on this part? It is not to scare or you know say how great this subject, it is not for that. It is just to emphasize that with just one additional aspect of the flow, that the flow is now instead of external, it has become internal, you have a all together a new dimension associated with the problem. You have to appreciate that there is a mean fluid temperature which necessarily has to be carried with you. And it is not a constant unlike T infinity. Okay. So I did not know this when I studied heat transfer. Okay. So the concept of hydraulic diameter all of us are familiar with. it essentially has come from the idea that you like to deal with circular pipe geometry. So, circular pipe geometry is something where I get the hydraulic diameter essentially equal to the diameter of the pipe. The definition historically has come from that aspect. So, 4 times flow area divided by the wetted perimeter, and I think this is not a big deal. Now, just as we had a hydrodynamic entrance length, that means where the velocity profile was changing, where there was an inviscid and the viscous region. Similarly, we have what we call as a thermal entrance length. Thermal entrance length is nothing but the region where the boundary layer is still developing. Just as the hydrodynamic boundary layer developed, this is the thermal boundary layer. It is developing till the point where the boundary layers intersect. We will call this as a thermal entrance length or thermal entrance region. Inside that region, let us say the fluid is entering at some temperature Ti, and the surface is maintained cooler than the fluid. So, heat has to go out from the fluid. So, a typical temperature profile would be like this. Okay. So, there will be a temperature distribution which goes from a higher value to a lower value as we move outward correspondingly here, and there will be a central portion where the boundary layer is not there. More important aspect here is what happens in the so called thermally fully developed region. I use the word so called because it is not very convincing for me to use the word thermally fully developed. Why? Because when I had hydrodynamic boundary layer and we said fully developed flow, I just had one very nice equation, d by dx of velocity equal to 0. What does it mean? Velocity profile is identical, or d by dx of the velocity is equal to 0, means irrespective of what x I am doing, the v is identical at every point. So, if I say at r equal to r by 2, if I take the velocity at this cross section versus another cross section, it is the same physical magnitude of velocity. The profiles are identical. So, I can superimpose all the profiles and there will be no change in the profile. Nothing will be outward or nothing will go in. It will be identical in shape and size. Am I clear on this? But now, when I come to thermal, things are not so nice. Why? Because few minutes ago we argued for this case where heat is going out from the pipe, what is happening? Let me say surface temperature is kept constant. This length will be constant because this is an indicator of the surface temperature. If heat is going out, the net energy content of the fluid is going to decrease with increasing length. Is everybody with me on this? If the net energy content is decreasing, this area represents the net energy content integral. That is what we did when we did mean temperature definition. So, if this is anchored and the area has to decrease, this curve will have to come inward. It has to sink inwards, and when it sinks in, what is changing? Ts is fixed locally at every point. Temperature is changing. Okay, if you are not able to appreciate it, I will just draw it for you here, and then I hope you will appreciate. I have this pipe. I will take the same case where Ts is smaller than T fluid at all points. This was one profile Ts at say x 1, at another profile at x 2, I am going to have x is equal to x 2, this is at x is equal to x 1, and this is my center line. This is velocity. If I draw, I just told you velocity if I cut the profiles and keep one over the other, you will not know what is the difference, it is identical. So, whatever be the velocity at x1, x2, the profile will be sitting one over the other. This is the velocity profile r comma x at all x values. In fact, I should not even be writing r comma x, it is just v of r. Whereas, here I can just looking at this tell you that if I move to x3, which is further downstream, and this t is being fixed, I will get a new curve which is going inwards. So, what does this mean? I cannot define thermally fully developed based on my temperature profile alone. I cannot define thermally fully developed. So, what we say, okay, let us make life a little bit complicated. We will say we have this ratio T, we have this ratio T S minus T divided by T S minus T M. This gradient of this ratio with respect to x is invariant with respect to x. What it means, T S is fixed. Let us say we deal with T S being fixed. T M is changing with respect to x, local T is also changing with respect to x. What we are saying, let us understand for T S is constant, that is easy. So, this term is constant, this is changing, this is sorry, see this gradient is invariant with respect to x. How did I come up with this? For a case with T S is equal to constant, that means this term, first term in the numerator and denominator is fixed, constant. Say wall is maintained at 100 degrees centigrade. T M is going to change with every x. T local is obviously going to change. T local being, I mean, changing is what is causing T M to change. All I am saying is this variation, the difference between the surface temperature and the local fluid temperature to surface temperature minus the so called mixing cup temperature. This non-dimensional theta, non-dimensional temperature is invariant with respect to x location. Temperatures are varying. T S is fixed, just for example case, T S is fixed. I am fixing T S for ease of understanding the situation. T S is fixed. T local, everybody appreciates, is going to vary because the fluid is either losing heat. In this case, the fluid is losing heat. I have drawn the velocity profile where I have shown that for the same point, let us take this point, this at this location, this fluid will have a temperature which is given by this. At x1, it would have had a temperature which is given by this. So, for the local temperature is going to change with x, mean temperature is also going to change with x. Just for simplicity, we will say surface temperature is constant. What we are saying is this non-dimensional temperature, which is nothing but T S minus T, which is the temperature difference between the surface and the local value to the temperature difference between the surface and the so called mixing cup temperature, which plays the role of some kind of an arbitrator. This is not independent, it is directly related to T. Remember your equation for T M, it was a big integral which had u times T dr, r times u of r x times T of r x times dr. So, this is not some magic, this is directly related to the temperature, it is in fact related also to the velocity. All we are saying is this change is such that it is invariant with respect to x. So, even though the temperature profile shape changes with respect to x at every location, what is constant is that this difference. So, if this differs, if let us say for example, this is 100 and at a local at a given location 100 minus say 80, and this is 100 minus 60. At another location, the ratio 100 minus 80 is 20 divided by 40, which is half. That ratio will still be half at another location. It's very crudely I am explaining with numbers. It is not correct to explain with numbers. What we are trying to say is a non-dimensional temperature profile, which is given by this, is invariant with respect to x. We have forgotten the actual velocity profile, actual temperature profile. We have introduced a non-dimensional velocity, non-dimensional temperature profile, which encompasses within it the velocity distribution and the temperature distribution. Right here, velocity distribution is also here. Okay, so this is what we call as so-called thermally fully developed. Okay, this has been the definition for thermally fully developed condition. Temperature is varying, agreed, mean temperature is varying, local temperature is varying, seemingly on front of it flow will never be thermally fully developed. That means dT by dx is definitely not equal to 0, dT by dx is definitely not equal to 0, unlike you had dV by dx, that is ruled out. So, okay, what do we do, how do we have something similar conceptually? So, instead of having a dimensional temperature, they say, okay, local temperature is influenced by what? It is influenced by the surface condition. Okay, fine. So, I somehow bring Ts. Also, some reference temperature has to be there. So, this reference temperature is what? T infinity is not possible anymore. So, Tm, but this Tm itself is influenced by the local temperature. So, I bring up this kind of a non-dimensional temperature profile, which will be invariant with respect to x. This is called as thermally fully developed. I am sure I have lost 50% of you. Open to questions.
Yeah, question is always very difficult for us. You will also face the same problem when you take up, when you introduce this, because boundary layer thickness. But fully developed for hydrodynamics, it's very easy to understand, but it's quite difficult to understand for thermal.
So how did one know that I have to take this ratio? That's why Professor Arun went at great lengths to make it understand, because in no textbooks they will define why is it defined like that. I mean, they will not make us understand. They will simply throw this and we are supposed to absorb it. So this is the best logic, I think, what Professor Arun has taught us. Is the best logic one can give. Both T is varying with x, Tm is also varying with x. So, both the variations I am trying to capture and then try to make it invariant. Then try to make it invariant. That's the only possible option one can think of.
What we are trying to say is probably that, I may be wrong, is that the nature of variation of T and Tm, obviously it should be similar, right? It cannot be different. We don't, intuitively it should not be different.
Correct.
So that logic probably has been used to come up with this.
And it works, and it works. People have found that Nusselt numbers after developing region, even although here we see, here professor always emphasized that for a minute let us take it is Ts. Now it becomes all the more difficult when I take a different boundary condition. Constant heat flux. It's very difficult. Now, how will you convince the student when you take constant heat flux that it will work? It's not possible. All that you will have to say that
it works.
It works.
So
it works. It indeed works. How do you say that it works? Because you have measured the heat transfer coefficients irrespective of the boundary condition what you have imposed, and then you indeed find that the heat transfer coefficient in the developing region it is constant. So that's why it works.
In the developed region.
In the developed region, in the developing region it is decreasing, and in the developed region it becomes constant. So that is why you say that it works. Okay, so this is the only plausible explanation one can offer. Okay,
sir, I have one question. Is there any stuff to work in developing region?
Meaning,
is there any people are working or people are doing the research based on the developing region?
Developing region, there are already empirical, not empirical, we have standard relations
derived, one can derive. That's what is, if I am right, Graetz problem. Venu or Saket can correct me. In the developing region, it's called as Graetz problem. G-R-A-E-T-Z. So that's developing region also, there are closed form solutions.
But what are we actually getting from the study on developing region?
In an heat exchanger. In an heat exchanger, you take all correlations. All correlations, which correlations you use? Developing correlations you use or fully developed correlations you use?
Fully developed.
And I will get a feel how much length I should keep so that I am always in the fully developed. Fully developed length. I don't know whether I have answered you. I didn't answer you. Your question, if I am understanding correctly, why at all I should be worried about heat transfer coefficients in the developing region? Is that right?
No. Maybe we can consider like that.
We can consider like that. Okay, no problem.
My question is in general, not to the heat transfer.
Okay.
As I see the papers of researchers, they are now focusing more on the developing region flows.
Is it?
So my question.
But
is
I thought that developing region, as far as developing region already closed form solutions.
Yeah, closed form solution is
so
there.
So then, what else is left out to study? I don't know.
Maybe when we are scaling
if configuration changes, if you put a twisted tape or if you put some other configuration inside, yes, then it becomes difficult.
The things become more tedious when you scale down the object.
Case. Scaling down, I am not going to deal with. I will deal with you alone, scaling down over a cup of coffee, but not here. Because things will change.
Yes.
Here we are taking TS is lesser than TI. If suppose reverse case is there, no heat loss will be there. Will the profile will same in that case?
Heat gain will be there by the fluid, right?
Okay. If the fully developed region, here we are getting different profiles due to the heat loss. But in that case,
I will draw it for you. In fact, I always teach it the other way, but it doesn't matter. It's just this. The profile will just change, that's all. So let us say we are in the developed region, so-called developed region. Yeah. I am making it really small. So it is like this. Purposely, I am making it too concave. This is x1. So roughly. And purposely, this is made fat. Okay. So TS.
No, this will. That I would like to ask. Will it change if it is constant heat flux coming in? No heat loss, suppose, because heat is coming in with the constant.
This heat is coming in, na?
Yeah.
This case is heat coming in. Okay. Let us not take uniform wall temperature.
So question is whether it is for heat flux.
Heat flux is a constant heat flux.
Okay.
So in that case, no heat loss will be there.
In any case, heat loss is not there.
Heat gain will be there, na? If constant heat flux is coming in. Yeah. Then what, let me just go back to this.
No, what is your question? I did not know.
No, doesn't matter.
TS also.
I kept saying TS is constant just for sake of understanding this concept.
Yeah. That's what I emphasized. Yes. Now it is hard to visualize.
Now I cannot visualize.
It's hard to visualize. That's why I said it works.
So,
that will also change. Yes.
What we are saying is, the change in the numerator and the change in the denominator happens identically at all axes. That is what I am saying.
Uniform heat flux condition, profile nature will be fixed. Only the thickness.
Thickness will change. Correct. So that is why this T and TM are coming into picture to take care of the bulging or the contraction of the profile. Because if the locally T is changing, TM is also going to correspondingly change. Whoever has come up with this has done a wonderful job actually.
One more question, sir. If the wall temperature is fixed constant, the velocity profile will also change because the fluid will get heated.
Correct.
It will not have same profile.
Coming in?
Now here what we have discussed that the velocity nature of the profiling is fixed. Okay.
Nature of
the velocity profile is fixed.
I never brought in velocity profile at all.
No, you know your point is velocity profile will change because my temperature profile is changing. No, 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 no.
Let us listen 1 minute. What are you saying?
Sir, this velocity profile, we assume that the nature is fixed when it is fully developed.
Hydrodynamically fully developed.
Hydrodynamically fully developed.
Right.
Okay. So if there is heating of fluid,
okay,
then there may be change in the volume of the fluid, there may be change in the viscosity of the fluid. And so it may affect the nature of the velocity profile.
So no, actually it doesn't work that way. In the developed region, in the fully developed region, velocity profile doesn't get affected because of the boundary condition. Because of heating, if I have to put it in, whether it is constant wall temperature or constant heat flux. No, it doesn't change. I will tell you why. Why historically, how are we solving this for internal flows? If I take, how do I solve this problem? How do I solve this problem? First, I write mass, momentum, and energy equation. I take the velocity profile independently, whether I heat or not. Because when I non-dimensionalize, I saw only Reynolds number. So I will keep the fluid fixed and I get the velocity profile. Now taking this velocity profile, I am going to put that velocity profile in my energy equation. If you remember, energy equation had u del t by del x plus v del. Now taking this velocity profile, I put the temperature. Now, what does this mean? If my velocity profile were to get affected by my temperature, then my momentum equation and energy equation would have been coupled.
Completely.
Coupled. That is what happens in natural convection. But here, these two are independent things. Velocity profile doesn't get affected at all because of heating or cooling. No two ways about it. No confusion on this score.
The temperature profile is getting affected by velocity.
Yes, but not the other way around. What the question is, because of temperature, velocity profile is affecting.
No.
That is not right.
Temperature profile.
What you said is right. Temperature profile is getting affected by my velocity profile because that is there in my bulk fluid temperature. Right? So velocity and temperature, they are going to go in one way. That is velocity comes first and then the temperature. But not
reverse.
Sir, I have a question that you have said that once you are finalizing the velocity profile inside the pipe, then you take the aid of dose profile and get the solution of temperature.
Yes.
I think this being a segregated solver, what you are solving.
Pardon, please?
Segregated part.
Okay.
But the flow, fluid flow and heat transfer is inherent. It is inherently a coupled phenomenon.
No, if it is coupled,
so
it
one
should
has to take care of. It's a recurrence formula.
No.
In first case, you are getting the steady state of the.
See, when will
profile.
It get? Well, then, if it were to be coupled, we would have coupled it in my equation itself, na?
See, whatever we are getting without taking care of the heat in the velocity profile, and if you are taking care of the heat transfer in the velocity profile.
The first question is whether my velocity profile gets affected at all or not. Forget equations.
Okay.
Whether my velocity profile will get affected or not.
I think it will get affected.
No, it will not.
What is that concept?
I think it's okay. It's a good question. I think the only way to convince you or convince ourselves is that, when will my velocity profile change? Let's go back to my m dot equal to rho a u.
Which of the things
changes means my velocity will change?
The mass flow rate doesn't.
No. Mass flow rate doesn't change. Please, I have to make you think. I have the answer in my mind. But until I get the answer from you, I am not able to reach you. When will my velocity, please listen to my question carefully, whoever are not getting this question. When will my velocity profile change? As long as my mass flow rate is constant, I cannot do anything about it. When will my velocity profile change? Only when my density changes. What is the basic assumption in all of this? What is the basic assumption in all of this analysis? My fluid is incompressible. You have landed into compressible flow. That is why you have gotten into problem. Okay? So my density is constant. So there is no way that my velocity profile is going to change with temperature. Okay? It took a while to reach you, but it's fine. No, that we will handle as property variations. Property variations. That we will handle it as property variations. Okay? In my m dot, viscosity, how does it come into my m dot? It's not coming. It's not. Temperature is varying. My velocity profile has to change, means who will have to change? No. M dot. What is m dot? M dot has to be conserved, no? Rho A U. If my velocity profile has to change, means the only way it can change is because of density, not because of viscosity. Not because of viscosity. Okay, that is why Prandtl number, we don't bother.
You are probably thinking of the momentum equation and there is a nu, therefore you are saying viscosity. Is that why you are saying?
No. How will velocity vary? How will velocity vary? No. How? Tell me how. No. It has to come obvious to us. No. Well, I can say m dot equal to rho a v. If my density decreases, my velocity has to increase. But similarly, can you convince me, if viscosity decreases, my mass flow rate either increases or decreases? Please convince me. Then only I can answer your question. There is no connection. There is no connection between viscosity and mass flow rate. There is no connection. I cannot answer it any other way. But all that I can say is, through m dot equal to rho a u only, viscosity has no influence on the mass flow rate. Okay?
Whatever the change has been done according to the temperature in terms of flow properties, ultimately it gets affected in Reynolds number. Until it reaches the certain critical Reynolds number, velocity profile doesn't change. If it gets beyond that limit,
that is for correlations to worry about. We have not reached there that
far. Yes,
yes. Okay. But that's fine. We had good discussion. It's better to get. Always my student, whenever my student are, when I get confused, I don't become restless at all. Confusion is the source of understanding. If I don't get confused, perhaps I'm not thinking. I'm just accepting things as they are. It's good to get confused. It took for me a while before I could not conceive initially how to answer your question. As it went along, it occurred to me, okay, this is what you are thinking. So it takes a while. You have made me think now. You have made me think. So I think it's better to get confused. Ultimately, we will get the answer. Eventually, we will get the answer.